All right, let's do this. Hello, everybody. Welcome back. And welcome to anybody who's just joined us for this session. I think a lot of people have joined because they heard that this was going to be the best session of the day. I can neither confirm nor deny, but we're going to absolutely do our best. And we have a great panelists. I'm Jamie Metzl, and I'm thrilled to be presiding over this, over our conversation today. Before I begin, just need to say that I get in trouble if I don't give the instructions, which are completely turn off, and if this is underlined, not just put on vibrate, no matter how enjoyable that sometimes is, your cell phones, Blackberries, and all wireless devices to avoid interference with the sound system. And this meeting is contrary to normally, or very often at the council, is on the record. So with that, we've been talking all day and last night about Asia, about America's role in Asia. You all know that America has been a continuous power in Asia with for over a century. So we see ourselves in, as a Pacific power. We are a Pacific power. But certainly, over the past more than half century, that presence has been strengthened and that connectivity has been strengthened through the alliance system. The alliance system began in the early 1950s with the alliance with Japan, and now there's Japan, Korea, Philippines, Australia, and Thailand, even though Thailand is sometimes in the doghouse. And we talk about the alliance system, that's what we're talking about. But then there are others who are kind of quasi-allies. And in that category, certainly there's Taiwan. And Singapore is behaving in many ways as a quasi-ally. And now with a strategic relationship, as Alyssa was mentioning in the last session, with India, it's certainly India is not a technical ally, but there's a lot of collaboration and cooperation between and growing between the United States and India. And for these past 60 plus years, this system has been both a foundation of the Asian order and, at least initially, an important mechanism for standing up against what was then seen as Soviet aggression. And we compare the development of these relationships and this quote-unquote system in Asia and what's happened in Europe, there's a big difference. Because in Asia, CETO, the Southeast Asia Treaty Organization, was tried. It failed. Unlike NATO, which succeeded in Europe. And the regional relationships and the regional structures and systems in Europe are much less strong than those regional structures and institutions in Asia, which is more, it rests upon more of a foundation of bilateral relationships. And ironically, that's true both for the United States and for China. In the Cold War, as I mentioned, the threat of the Soviet Union and of communism pulled these alliance relationships, cemented these alliance relationships together. And then when China began to rise, particularly when they were doing so under the banner of peaceful rise, a lot of questions were raised about whether this alliance system was even needed at all. And I, at that time, was going back and forth. And everywhere I went, people would say, thank you so much for your service. Things are, Asia is maturing to a level where now it can handle its own affairs. Thank you, but we can take things from here. And it's ironic how different things seem now that China's orientation is at least perceived as being quite different. And with these kind of conflicts that we're seeing in the South China Sea and East China Sea and elsewhere, there's a new life for this alliance system, but still important questions remain of whether the alliance system underpins with the development of regional relationships and regional systems in Asia, or it undermines the development of those systems. And I think that there would be different views based on where you sit. I think certainly people from this perspective would say, most people would say it underpins, and people in Beijing might say it undermines. To address these and many other topics related to this, we have just a fantastic group of speakers. You all have their bios in your booklet, so I won't say too much. But just very quickly, Sheila Smith is an expert in Japanese politics and foreign policy, which was proven by her outstanding performance in the last session. And she's a senior fellow for Japan Studies at the CFR, and very importantly is the author of this fantastic book called Intimate Rivals, Japanese Domestic Politics and a Rising China. So I certainly encourage everybody to please have a look at this book. Euan Graham is Director of International Security Program at the Lowy Institute. He is a former research analyst at the UK Foreign and Commonwealth Office, and very interestingly was the chargé d'affaires at the British Embassy in Pyongyang. And he also is the author of a recent book called Japan's Sea Lane Security, 1940 to 2004, A Matter of Life and Death? And Snyder, who I've known for many years, is a senior fellow for Korea Studies and director of the program on U.S.-Korea policy at the CFR. He directed the CFR's independent task force on policy towards the Korean Peninsula. And he also is the author of the book, is it out or forthcoming?
Forthcoming.
Called Japan-Korea Identity Conflict. So I hope everybody will please pick up these books and read them and enjoy them and tell your friends. And so with that, just I mentioned different perspectives, kind of a more American perspective and a more Chinese perspective. But one thing that Xi Jinping himself has said, he has called these alliances a Cold War relic. And that's part of calling for a new Asia security concept, which presumably would not be based on these alliances. So why don't we start with a little bit going back into the history and exploring at least the Cold War origins of these relationships as a foundation for then beginning to explore their relevance today. And because Japan was first, maybe Sheila will start with you.
Okay, thank you, Jamie. I'm delighted to be back. So the Japanese-U.S.-Japan alliance was born alongside the peace treaty, the San Francisco peace treaty that restored Japanese sovereignty in 1952. I alluded to this in the earlier panel. The first bilateral treaty had no U.S. commitment to Japan's defense. There was 360,000 American servicemen on Japanese soil at the end of the occupation. It was largely a basing treaty. So in the late 1950s, because of popular criticism of the alliance, Mr. Abe's grandfather, Prime Minister Kishi, instituted a renegotiation of the terms of that treaty. So the treaty we refer to today is the 1960 treaty. It's a mutual security commitment. The United States, under Article 5, is obligated to the defense of Japan. And under Article 6, the Japanese government is obligated to provide facilities and bases for U.S. forces, which will stabilize the Far East. So that's the basic security bargain wrought by Japan in 1960. Over the Cold War, Japan was largely a supporting actor in U.S. Cold War strategy, if you think particularly of the military part of the alliance. If there was a contingency in Korea, the two militaries were organized on how they would respond. Japanese bases would be available. Any kind of logistical support the U.S. forces needed would be available. There's no mention, no thought of Japanese forces going to fight on the Korean Peninsula, for example. There was no mention of Taiwan. Right? Taiwan was a very quiet conversation in the bilateral relationship. It was there, but it certainly was an overt part of the Japanese perception of the alliance until the 1990s. 1980s, this audience will be familiar with the U.S. and Japan, had quite a strong conversation about Japan's rising economic power. It was the era of burden sharing in the U.S. Congress. The United States Congress wanted Japan to spend more money if it wasn't going to participate fully militarily. This was the moment when the economic superpower ought to invest more in its own defense and ought to spend more on our forces in Japan as well. So the burden sharing era is also very much a part of our history, the latter part of the Cold War, but it's an important piece of the alliance puzzle for us. And then the post-Cold War period, I think we can talk about later, but it has really been a massive adjustment for Japanese and American thinkers about what the role of this alliance is and what the roles and missions and capabilities in defense speak, what that means and how we're going to share this in this rapidly changing Asia.
Terrific. Scott, a little background on the Korea alliance?
Sure. Well, I think the United States learned the hard way about the importance of Korea to regional security in Northeast Asia. In January of 1950, Dean Acheson gave a speech that excluded the Korean Peninsula from the U.S. security perimeter. 6 months later, the Korean War started. Following the war, maybe the feature of the formation of the alliance that is most interesting is that it was really established, I think, primarily as a product of U.S. ROK mistrust. Because following the war, a main concern of U.S. security planners was that Lee Sung-man would go back north and try to restart the Korean War. He didn't sign the armistice. This relationship from the 50s was a patron-client relationship where the United States guaranteed South Korea's security. South Korea didn't have to do anything. I think the remarkable development in the alliance in the post-Cold War period has been the emergence of a democratic, market-based economic South Korea as a partner of the United States. And we have seen the scope of the alliance expanding especially 2009 with the Joint Vision Statement. It's natural, I think, that from a Chinese perspective, the alliance relationship between the U.S. and South Korea might feel or seem a little bit like a Cold War relic because, after all, the Chinese were on the other side in the Korean War, an enemy of South Korea. But in the early 90s, they developed a vibrant economic relationship. China is South Korea's largest trading partner. And at one point, I think in the mid-2000s, the Chinese saw South Korea as low-hanging fruit. They were waiting for troubles in the U.S.-ROK relationship to develop in such a way that all China would have to stand there and be the alternative. But over the course of the past decade, I think that what we have seen is a very interesting correlation, not causation necessarily, between South Korean angst about the implications of China's rise and rising levels of support for the U.S.-ROK security alliance. So now we have an alliance that is a partnership, it is multifaceted, and it's still primarily focused on North Korea, but China is in the back of everyone's mind.
Euan, Southeast Asia and Australia?
Thank you, Jamie. Maybe I'll, as I'm here with Lowy, I'll start with ANZUS, which, although Japan was first, I think ANZUS was just one day afterwards.
Yes.
So it has been right there from the start.
Mm-hmm.
In many ways, I think it's the sort of least troubled relationship for the United States. That's borne out in the record of continuous contributions mm-hmm. that Australia has been there pretty much in every
right.
war that that America's fought in that period since the alliance was founded. And that's reflected also in very high levels of popular support for the alliance within Australia. The New Zealand component of that, a little more troubled, back in the 1980s and the policies of the Labour government in New Zealand towards not allowing nuclear mm-hmm. power or nuclear weapons within its territory. We've seen kind of a bit of a move back to the back into the fold, if you like, of ANZUS as it was originally conceived. But the Australian-US relationship, I think, remains probably the most steadfast mm-hmm. of the hub-and-spoke arrangements. And also, President Obama, I think, not by coincidence, chose to give his clearest articulation of the rebalance in Canberra.
Mm-hmm.
And we've seen that there's continual growth starting with the Marine Detachment, so in the current context mm-hmm. of the rebalance, Australia has also had a sort of front and center role there. And that's borne out again in the sort of reciprocal, in relative terms, quite substantial contribution that the Australian government has made to the ISIL campaign
right.
in the form of special forces and air forces. Shifting focus up to Southeast Asia, we also have the Philippines as one of the sort of original mm-hmm. groupings, obviously a kind of legacy of the special relationship between U.S. and the Philippines, but also more troubled into the bargain. And of course, as is obvious, I think, to all of the audience, the key watershed period that put the alliance into its most troubled period was in the early 1990s mm-hmm. when the Philippine Congress voted to eject U.S. forces and the bases were closed down. Things come around, and now we're sort of in a period of revitalization with the EDCA arrangement having been agreed between U.S. and Philippines, And although we're not looking, I think, at any kind of formalized basing presence, nonetheless, the Philippines, by virtue of its peculiar strategic geography, is also, I think, uniquely valuable to the US in a Southeast Asian context. Thailand, I think, more of a Cold War arrangement in the way that it came to be. We could talk a little bit more about that later on. But I just flag also, as I'm coming from Singapore into Australia, that Singapore, although not in the formal alliance system, has arguably become more important than some of the formal allies in Southeast Asia. And I think that that's the interesting thing about Southeast Asia in the rebalance. It's a much more fluid environment where the partnerships in some ways have the momentum.
Yeah, and it's interesting that these relationships are developing in response, of course, to changing circumstances. That in the beginning there was a Cold War and an anti-Soviet orientation, and then there was a question of what they were really for, and now with this growing fear of China, this spread certainly throughout maritime Asia pretty evenly. There's a strong sense in many of these countries that the U.S. Bilateral relationship, whether it's Japan or Korea or Philippines or even others like Vietnam who aren't allies, but that bilateral relationship is essential for their continuity. But there's a question, because there's also a movement towards stronger multilateral institutions in Asia. As I mentioned before, the institutions in Asia, whether it's the ASEAN Regional Forum or East Asia Summit, or there's a bunch of them, are not nearly as strong as those kinds of institutions in Europe. And the question is, too, and one is, I think Scott, Scott framed it in our earlier conversations. One question for us to explore is, does this series of bilateral relationships constitute a quote-unquote system? And if so, or even regardless of the answer to that, is there a conflict between this series of bilateral relationships and the development of meaning multilateral institutions in Asia? Maybe, Scott, maybe we'll start with you.
Well, I think that the tension really there is over the question of collective versus cooperative security and how those forms of cooperation might be institutionalized going forward. And I'll just say that I think that that is a dynamic question in Asia. It is an evolving and organic question, and I think that it is related to the fact that we really don't know yet what the future of China's rise really is going to be and its implications for the security system in the Asia Pacific. And so everybody, I think, generally speaking, is more in this engaging and hedging mode.
Right.
And so the engagement comes, I think, primarily in direct interaction with China and in cooperative and institution building, trying to import international norms into the region. But you know, there's also this element of hedging, which I think that we see both in the bilateral alliances and in the fact that the rebalance creates an environment in which increasingly the United States is anticipating and expecting greater cooperation among allies with each other and partners in various forms. And so we're in this very, I think, delicate phase, because we know that China doesn't like the rebalance. And probably the reason why they don't like the rebalance is because they don't really think that a NATO model should be transferred to Asia. At the same time, the administration, when it talks about the rebalance, a lot of focus goes onto the alliances, but the second priority was actually engagement with China and other emerging powers. And I think that this administration has actually been quite robust in its efforts to engage with China. I think that's a point that sometimes when we talk about the rebalance, it actually gets lost. And then the third point is regional institution building, which is really about cooperative security, but for the purpose of placing China's rise into context and providing some socializing effect on the impact of China's rise.
Mm-hmm. Sheila?
You know, when you were talking, Jamie, I thought it might be useful to take a step back and think a little bit about that. I don't want to spend too much time in Cold War history, but we often think in the United States that when we talk about the Cold War, it's the Soviet Union we're talking about. And if you think about the Cold War in Asia, if you're an Asia historian, especially a post-war historian, right, the hot war of the Korean War, as Scott said, produced the alliance with Korea, produced the alliance with Japan. So the Cold War manifested itself most dangerously in Asia. And the second piece of the puzzle we haven't introduced, but it's probably important, is the Southeast Asians themselves decided that they needed a security community. We talk about ASEAN, mm-hmm. but that was a product of the 1960s and a recognition that Southeast Asia needed it to get over its own internal kind of tensions and irritations. So today's multilateralism in Asia is largely built over two things. One is the shift in the way we perceive China, which began in the 1970s and really bifurcated that Cold War experience for Asia. But also it's resting on this ASEAN foundation of multilateralism in the region. I suspect the rebalance, as we look out and look at our engagement with the region, part of it is a rebalancing of our priorities. American foreign policy priorities are being rebalanced, right? It's rebalancing our diplomatic attention to Southeast Asia, which had been underserved, I think, in many ways, in our conception of our interests in Asia. But it's also kind of the straddling between our traditional military allies and this rising China. Mm-hmm. And again, for the Japan story, that straddling is really at the front and center of the way we're struggling to reaffirm our commitments, but also understand how it's changed the commitments that we do make mm-hmm. to the Japanese. But Japan, other countries around the region have been much more invested in multilateralism. We came late to the mm-hmm. game, as you know. President Obama has made the East Asia Summit participation, at least in theory, a hallmark of his rebalance to Southeast mm-hmm. Asia. But we wanted to participate actively in the institution building itself. But we came late to the prospect, and Japan has been there. China, in the 1980s and into the 1990s, was actually a fairly active mm-hmm. participant as well. So whether, you know, I think collective security is not what we're envisioning. I don't know that anybody, and I'd be interested in Euan's point, nobody wants to go back there in knitting them all together to make it look like NATO. Mm-hmm. But it's somewhere in between a collective security arrangement and a genuine cooperative security conception, yeah. I think.
Euan?
Well, there was an attempt to do so. There was mm-hmm. a Southeast Asian right. Treaty Organization, right. which founded for precisely yep. the reasons that we talked about. That brings me into mind, I think that there is a disjuncture, if you like, between the nuts and bolts of the security relationship and what diplomatically the hopes invested in ASEAN as a vehicle for kind of collective engagement. I think that's the role it fulfills, but up to a fairly low glass ceiling. There isn't the uniformity of threat perceptions or capabilities mm-hmm. between the Southeast Asian countries towards China in particular, and that's been very manifest in terms of the fault lines that we've seen emerging in the South China Sea. So there, I think, to get again back to the sort of mechanisms through which American delivers its defense engagement, I think it's much more at the sort of bilateral level, but not just with the traditional alliances. Here again, Singapore comes to mind because it's a quasi-alliance which sort of operates at the level of without a formal treaty obligation on either side. And frankly, that's really where Singapore likes to have it. I think the US has offered a treaty status to Singapore, and Singapore is quite happy where it is, because it is, again, Southeast Asia is that much closer to China. Mm-hmm. Australia is much further away. Japan also has its own, it's just a more binary relationship, I think. Southeast Asia is more fluid. And ASEAN serves as a kind of cloak that you can wear to socialize China. Mm-hmm. That's the hope that's placed within it. But as a vehicle for security cooperation, it's consistently under-delivered, and I think that's an open secret, that it's really a way of getting the disparate Southeast Asian countries together to give them a collective voice as well, mm-hmm. because going back to another historical question, the origin of ASEAN was precisely for that reason. It was originally a non-communist grouping, mm-hmm. But primarily just sort of to present a collective face, because the fault line of the Cold War ran hot through yeah. Southeast Asia for a long decade, yep. And that memory is still there. And there is a common refrain now that you hear, almost a mantra in Southeast Asia, that no country wants to choose between China mm-hmm. and the United States. Yes. It is a mantra.
Yeah.
But there again, you see the same fear reflected, that Southeast Asia, I think, fears that it, of all the sub-regions within the macro Indo-Pacific, has the most potential to be a kind of theater for proxies and great power zones of influence and rivalry.
Yeah, and let me stay with you, Euan, because in that context, there is a perception struggle. I mean, some say that there's a bit of a China bubble in perceptions, because when countries are thinking about hedging, they all will need to do their calculus of what the relativity of power is. And if it's 80-20 U.S. to China, it leads you to make very different decisions and thinking differently strategically than if you see it as a 50-50 or it's something moving towards a 50-50. And that brings us back to something that's been a theme throughout this conference, which is the rebalance. And so my question, starting with you, Euan, is does the continuity, the continued strength of the alliance system require a success, at least a perceived success, of the rebalancing, in the sense that as China continues to grow, as we've seen China, this Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank, China handled it extremely well. The United States handled it, in my opinion, extremely poorly. If we have more of these kinds of situations, will there be a perception shift, and will that undermine the alliance system? And I start with you, Euan, because in Japan and even with Korea, some of those situations are more cemented. Japan has its interests, Korea has its interests and its history, but Southeast Asia, it feels a little bit more up for grabs.
Yeah. Well, as Sheila mentioned, part of the there was a rebalance within the rebalance, the idea of having a more sort of distributive footprint to away from Northeast Asia. The composition of the panel, in fact, reflects the fact that the big load-bearing alliances are up north. I mean, Australia is a sort of southern maritime anchor, but in Southeast Asia, it's much more disparate. Let me come out and say I'm in favor of the rebalance. I think it was a kind of bumper sticker that was well received, and there were demand signals that presaged it within Southeast Asia around that sort of 2008-2009 time, when Chinese assertiveness began to sort of become more manifest and to start to concern some of those Southeast Asian, particularly the maritime countries, the continental countries much less so. And I think Cambodia, Laos, Myanmar are in rather a different camp. Vietnam's the interesting one, because geographically it's both continental and maritime, and maybe it's shifting more towards the maritime identity over time. I think Southeast Asia collectively can be a very fickle audience as well, because there is a long-standing oscillation between perceptions of the United States being either over-militarized or inattentive. And it's very difficult to get that middle spot right. I think the rebalance was an attempt to do that. The problem is that in making policy hostage to that bumper sticker, you are then subjecting yourself to constant testing of whether you are paying enough diplomatic attention, enough military attention, enough economic attention without over-egging that. And I think we saw in the way that the rebalance was rolled out with the military first, I think there was a kind of reaction against that in Southeast Asia that verged much towards the over-militarization spectrum fear. I think that's been overcome recently. I think also in China's eyes, if we're looking at, for example, the littoral combat ships which have been stationed out of Singapore, I don't think China sees that as a strategic game shifter any more than the deployment of 2,500 Marines in North Darwin is going to make a real strategic shift. But nonetheless, I think the deficit, to the extent it's now felt in perceptions, is much more on the economic leg of the rebalance rather than the military. I think most people understand and they get the military side. They may have perceptions that it goes a little bit too far sometimes, but I think they don't doubt it. What they really, I think the doubt more is about the economic sustainability and how far that can be perpetuated in U.S. policy.
Right. So Sheila, let's stick with the military side of things with in relation to Japan. One of the challenges of the alliance relationship between the United States and Japan is that it works really well for the kinds of scenarios that it was built to address. So if somebody does an invasion of Japan, it's really clear what the United States would do and is required to do. But China has been very, very smart, both in with the Philippines and with Japan, of using the so-called salami slice tactic. You just do a little bit at a time, just a small slice of the salami each time. You still may wind up with cutting away a lot of the salami, but at each point, if China is just doing some small provocation, some small advance, putting more ships into Japanese territorial waters, nothing ever rises to the level where the alliance is triggered. Is the salami slice strategy, or the so-called salami slice strategy, a challenge to the alliance system, both in reality and in perception?
Yes, most definitely. So there's two different challenges, and I think if you're sitting from Tokyo's perspective, clearly they felt that the United States wasn't forward-leaning enough. Right. Mm-hmm. So there's always been, as you know, there's always been some ambiguity in the American position on the Senkaku Islands, Diaoyu, as the Chinese refer to them. We do not take a stance, our official policies, we do not take a stance on the ultimate sovereignty of those islands. And that dates from the early 1970s, when both Taiwan and the PRC made a claim for those islands. But we do extend the protections of Article 5 of the Security Treaty to territories administered by Japan. So it's a very careful dance that our State Department does. The end result being that the Senkaku Islands are covered by Article 5 protections, right? The Japanese government has never been comfortable with that dance that we do. Before the Nixon administration, we always referred to the residual sovereignty of the Japanese over the Ryukyu and Bonin Islands. But we shifted gears slightly when we returned those islands with the Okinawa Reversion Treaty. So Japanese government officials will say, you should just say that they're ours. Why did you shift gears? Mm-hmm. And that goes back to our recognition of China, to the complex dynamics in Asia of the mid-70s. So today, they certainly like us to go back to that original position. So that's a kind of ambivalence on the Japanese side. The fact is, we don't have naval ships defending the Senkakus. We don't patrol the East China Sea. The Japanese Coast Guard does. Its own navy, in fact, stays well away from the disputed islands, from the Senkakus. Even though they don't acknowledge they're disputed, they are very careful about where the Japanese military goes. In 2010, we had a small incident with a fishing trawler captain. In 2012, we had the introduction of Chinese forces patrolling those islands. And since then, I think most Japanese feel that the status quo has already changed. Mm-hmm. Right? You have now, you don't necessarily have the same schedule, but you have Chinese vessels in the waters of these islands. You have Japanese Coast Guard vessels as well. What they don't want, however, is any kind of mishap or escalatory path that would then raise the threshold, which is getting to your question. Secretary of State Clinton was absolutely clear in 2010, the alliance covers the Senkakus. Mm-hmm. John Kerry, when he came in as Secretary of State, very clearly reiterated the alliance covers the Senkakus. President Obama last year went to Tokyo and for the first time at the presidential level reiterated the American commitment. So our Senate has made a statement, we will accept no unilateral or coercive basis for trying to change the status quo. So, but behind the scenes, the United States government has also tried to convey to Xi Jinping and to the leadership in Tokyo that any kind of escalatory dynamic, any kind of challenging that could lead to war would not be in American interests, right? So there's been a quiet conversation with both parties to this dispute, and that's also been part of the U.S. role. So it hasn't just been a deterrent role, although that's an important part of it. It has also been persuasion for both parties to walk down, to think about risk reduction measures, to think about confidence building. Right. And that's what came out of the Xi-Abe meeting last November.
Yeah. And Scott, last question before we open it up for everybody. Presumably, I believe, someday, I actually believe sooner rather than later, there will be a reunification of Korea. Barbara Demick, I think, is in the audience, who's the real expert in all of this, among the other two wonderful experts we have here on this topic. But do you think that the U.S.-Korea alliance could survive a Korean reunification with China playing some kind of positive role in that process?
I do think that the alliance could survive it, but I don't think that it is. I think it's an open question. Mm-hmm. Before going into that, I just want to say, because listening to this conversation and thinking back on Danny Russell last night, how glad I am that I don't have his job. Mm-hmm. because I think that, you know, one of the challenges for the rebalance is really, there are three main challenges, I think. One is the necessity of providing assurance to allies, and it's constant. It has to be done every day. The second is a coordination challenge, and that is, as Euan was suggesting, everybody has a different sweet spot for where they want to see the U.S.-China relationship be. How much competition, how much cooperation. And the third one, I think that's in the back of everybody's minds, and this gets back to the Korean unification question, is sustainability. As China rises longer term, how does U.S. staying power look, and where will it be? And so I think those things are going to be on the minds of Koreans at the point of unification. But I think that the other, you know, critical challenge for the region in the context of a unified Korean peninsula is that it basically creates a situation where everybody is going to be waiting to see what Korea chooses, right? A unified Korea, ironically, could be more unstable than a divided Korea because both China and Japan see the Korean peninsula as critical to their security interests. And so that is, I think, the issue that is going to be most challenging to navigate. I think an alliance with the United States may be able to play a contributing role in that conversation, but I think it's really complicated to know how it is actually going to come out.
Yeah. All right. So great topics raised in our preliminary conversation. I'm sure other things that we haven't addressed and would love to know what's on your mind. And they usually say just a question, but happy to have a question or a quick reflection, but not too long. And we'll start with in the back with the blue tie.
Hi, I'm David Grupo, and I wanted to ask you a little bit about Japan's interest in Southeast Asia. So it seems in recent years, Japanese investment and commercial and financial has been quite significant and quite welcomed into, you know, Burma, Vietnam, and so on and so forth. And it seems, as a non-expert, somewhat as a counterbalance to China, right? But how does Japanese increased presence there change the dynamic of this discussion going forward?
Yeah, sorry.
It's a great question. I would hesitate to characterize Japanese interests in Southeast Asia as being driven by China. They have always had, and since the beginning of the post-war period, and even earlier than that, of course, if we go back to earlier points of history and sea lanes and things like that, there's a deep Japanese strategic interest in Southeast Asia. And so part of the diplomatic work that the Japanese had to do in the 1950s was to go negotiate treaties with those Southeast Asian countries that were not participants in San Francisco. So Japan has invested heavily, has deep trading relations throughout Southeast Asia. Japan was, after the ASEAN was formed in the early 90s, when ASEAN began to think about this role perhaps as a talk shop or confidence building mechanism, when the ASEAN Regional Forum idea came to the fore, Japan was a huge supporter in the institutionalization of that dialogue. So Japan's interest in Mr. Abe has been very conspicuous in going to the Southeast Asian countries. I think he's been to almost all of them.
All 10.
Twice, or all 10, at least once, and some of them twice. He has really reinvigorated Japan's ties both economically and strategically with the countries of Southeast Asia. So it is natural, Japanese national interest as opposed to rising China. That being said, there is a context today in which there are many countries in Southeast Asia who are happy to see the Japanese be more activist in their economic relationships in particular. And I suspect that there is, on the receiving side, a little bit, if not a counterbalance to China, at least a little gratitude that there's more players at the table. So I think that's an area we should expect the Japanese to continue to be active. I think we should just, there's a little bit of careful adjustment here in the AIIB for Japan is an opportunity I would like them to see them cautiously consider and move forward with. I think I'd rather see the embrace of building institutions of cooperation between Japan and China across the region to build those ties back up again rather than to see them just devolve into competition in the region. So it's a natural place for Japan to be active.
Euan?
Just to add to what Sheila had said, I mean, there's nothing new about Southeast Asia's place in Japan's economic and security policy writ large. But there was a very conscious attempt for most of that post-war period not to have a military component to that. That's beginning to change now, and we are seeing the germ of a defense relationship, very small steps. And of course, Japan is acutely aware that if it steps in Southeast Asia, China will very quickly react, and then it may end up losing more than it gains from investing in that kind of new relationship. Nonetheless, there is added to that now a new alliance component in this. We're awaiting the new defense guidelines, US-Japan defense guidelines, to be announced, and I think it seems likely that there will be a push to redefine the alliance in more regional terms. And we've seen some indications recently with senior US naval flag officers raising the idea of Japan playing a more direct role in the form of air patrols in the South China Sea. Some pushback from the Japanese defense establishment, interestingly, on that. They say that we have our hands full as it is. And I think the kind of Japanese military cultural default in the post-war period is not to say what you're doing, despite the very significant capability that Japan does have. But I think in that alliance dynamic, as the US, for reasons of financial constraints and also the diversion of resources into the Middle East, is going to have an increasing requirement for allies to be present more in the South China Sea. And I think Japan, for its capabilities and because of the strength of the alliance and because of its own national interests in Southeast Asia and the South China Sea, is going to be at the receiving end of more of those demands.
Yeah, and it's very interesting how the number of players in this space is increasing, not just the United States and now Japan, but even India now with its relationship to Vietnam and others. So it's getting a lot more complicated. All right, Jeff.
Thank you, Jamie. Jeff Laurenti. I wonder if you all could comment on the kind of juridically ambiguous status of the diplomatically unrecognized Chinese Republic on Taiwan, the degree both for Washington and for the Japanese, the Koreans, and the various countries of Southeast Asia. Taiwan appears on the radar screen as a place of potential security interest, either covert or more overt kinds of defense ties, and whether there is any sense that beyond the ideal, which is let nothing change, a sense of how in each of these quarters some kind of rapprochement between Taipei and Beijing might proceed. Is that actually viewed as alarming to some, and just better keep the current ambiguous status of this not insubstantial island and economy as it is?
And let me just add to that question, because two accentuating factors. One is Taiwan's perception of the crackdown against the pro-democracy students in Hong Kong and China's failure to live up to its commitment about selection of their leaders. And then linked to that is the very likely, at least from the perspective of now, success of the DPP in the next year's elections, which it seems that we've had this kind of good ECFA calm relationship between under Taiwan under KMT and China, but all of that looks like it's about to change. So who would like to? Sheila?
I can dive in on the Japan piece of the puzzle, right? And if you close your eyes and imagine the East China Sea, which I know all of you can do, you know, Taiwan is not very far away from those disputed islands, and Taiwan, of course, has a stake in those islands that are disputed. Ma Ying-jeou's leadership of Taiwan during both the 2010 and 2012 crises between Beijing and Tokyo was very important, and it's largely because he took a very astute path. He decided for the first time that he would, you know, move towards Tokyo in concluding a fisheries treaty and literally opt out of the territorial dispute, and thereby leaving it to be just a Beijing conversation, right? That was very adroit. He himself has a PhD. He wrote his PhD thesis on these islands and the East China Sea. He also has a East China Sea peace proposal, so for how to reduce tensions, how to build community around that maritime region. So all I'm saying is I think Tokyo and Beijing were quite lucky that they, A, had the Cross Straits peace going well, and B, that they had Ma Ying-jeou, who understood fundamentally what Taiwan's peace or stake in that was. If you move beyond this, let's just say we do get a different leadership that is much more combative towards Beijing. That's just a big if. I don't know. I don't know what that means for the island dispute itself. I don't know for how that leadership in Taipei is going to rethink the fisheries treaty. I don't know what they're going to think about the island claim itself, but it will complicate a very slow progression by Beijing and Tokyo towards building some kind of confidence building. We shouldn't forget the fact that a Taiwan Straits crisis occurred in 1996 around an election. The United States will be watching it very carefully, clearly. Our role in sort of damping down the DPA's ambition for independence and in demonstrating to Beijing that we would respond, signaling at least that we would respond, it was very critical in 1996. If we find ourselves working our way back there, the Washington policymakers will have a very complicated East China Sea to think about, not just a Taiwan decision-making process, but a much more complicated maritime space and regional space, I think.
Just quickly.
Politics aside, I mean, on a more strategic note, it is almost paradoxical that Taiwan has sat there as a sort of quiet spot in the eye of the storm that's raged both in the East China Sea and in parallel in the South China Sea. And I think we need to remember that it's intimately involved. I mean, China's claim arguably runs through Taiwan to the Senkaku Diaoyu. And in the South China Sea, Taiwan owned, until China built an artificial island that's bigger, the largest feature within the Spratly Islands. So it's, and of course the infamous 9 or 10 dash line has its origins as a Kuomintang document. So it's there, it'll have to be part of a solution too, and its status as a non-recognized, it's not a state, the other Southeast Asians don't have relations with it. That will also eventually have to be a piece in the puzzle of how you move beyond the South China Sea tensions. But for China, in military strategic terms, Taiwan is enormously important. And if we're talking about this island chain, that secures open access to the Pacific. And I don't think that should be forgotten or something that can be subsumed entirely between a relationship, cross-strait relationship, which goes well for a few years. But I think fundamental strategy will continue to occupy attention.
Yeah, that last is a very important point. Yes.
Manik Mehta, again on Taiwan, I have a question related to the Taiwan Relations Act. Mm-hmm. How relevant is that today, considering the mood in the country against, engagement overseas by GIs and what have you? Would you like to comment, anyone?
Anyone want to pick that up, Scott?
This is really out of my area, but, the TRA, it creates a legislative requirement for the United States to come to Taiwan's defense. Mm-hmm. In the event of, I'm being corrected by the audience, so I better stop where I'm on my head. But, my understanding is that there's...
This is the thing where if you're in the audience and you shout out a challenge to the speaker, then you get 30 seconds to give your response to this question. So if you give, and you were the next person on that question list, so your thoughts on the TRA and then your question. Well, I think he deferred to you.
That's what happens, Sarah.
You speak up. It's you. You get to speak up. The mic.
Will come to you.
But you had a question anyway.
Where is the mic?
Yeah.
Herbert Levin. We had a security treaty with the Republic of China and Taiwan, from which we withdrew. At the time that the Congress passed the Taiwan Relations Act, which was mostly about how you carry on your business in Taiwan in the absence of diplomatic relations, there's a paragraph in there which says that we can sell them arms for their security, and then there's a general thing about how we will take note of any threats to peace and security in the area. There's no statement about any kind of defense commitment to Taiwan.
Right, there's just a perception that we've allowed to maintain that.
It isn't a perception. Yeah. It's something that the Navy brings up in time when their budget is threatened to pretend that they have a commitment to defend Taiwan, but we don't have one.
No. So there's not a paper, but there's enough strategic ambiguity. Yes.
There is something
defense of Japan.
Adequate defense of Taiwan. Not that we will come to Taiwan's rescue in the case of an attack, but that we are committed to the maintenance.
No, that's those sails.
Well, it's not defined as sail.
Yes, it is.
All right, so hold on.
I'm going to find the language.
Okay, good. This is the kind of conflict that we welcome at the Council on Foreign Relations because it makes these things more exciting. But we have, yes.
I think this provision says that any attempts to change the status quo in Taiwan Strait would be viewed with grave concern by the United States.
Mm-hmm. All right, good.
All right.
Herb. Now,
all
your
clear.
Questions. Yes, Herb. Bring it.
I don't like this alliance system. The treaty with Japan is not a mutual security treaty. We defend them, and they let us come in to make money when the ships come in, but they have no commitment to defend us. The treaty with Korea, the Koreans have made it absolutely clear that we are there to defend them, but we cannot use it as basis to do anything else against China or anything else. The Koreans told the United States that they had informed China that if there's disturbance in the north and they must go north to help their brothers, the American forces will not move north. So I don't see any alliance system there. We've already disposed of Taiwan. President can defend anything he wants to, but there isn't any alliance there. And as for the Philippines, please, they threw us out of the bases. We should have withdrawn from the treaty. But the Navy thought we might want to go back. There's no plan to go back. There's no one in the Philippines who talks about having us come back there. You know, so the idea that we're going to go and defend some mud bank out in the South China Sea because of this treaty with the Philippines is patently absurd. So there, we have alliances. And we have interests, but we don't have an alliance system.
Yeah, and I think that was the point that Scott was making.
Can we take it?
All right, Jeff, stop. Stop laughing. All
right. Go ahead, Scott.
Yeah, well, so I think that's the point that Scott was making earlier, is this a system? And that also, the point that you make, is that the model is itself changing from these kind of heavy touch relationships like the Philippines used to be to light touch relationships like we have with the Philippines now and with Singapore. So Scott,
That's absolutely right. I mean, I think that the title over-delivers for this panel. And so you're right to point that out. I do have to say that I don't know of any bound that the South Koreans have pledged to China on the disposition of U.S. forces in the event of a conflict on the Korean Peninsula.
They wouldn't send U.S. forces north, like Germany didn't send
NATO. I think the Chinese have expressed a desire not to see U.S. forces go north, but I know that there are specific scenarios where involving nuclear management where the U.S. probably would do that regardless of any preference by Beijing.
Yeah. Sheila.
Is it okay?
Yes. Yeah. We've woken everybody up in the late morning.
No. Two things. I think people, I take Herb's point about the use of the word system. Okay. So, but here's the point. The point is we've got 60 some years of military cooperation relationships, slightly organized differently in Japan, organized differently in the Republic of Korea, organized differently in the Philippines. We have alliances, we have troops on the ground. To my knowledge, nobody really expected anybody to attack the Philippines, and therefore there was no mindset of a conspicuous American guarantee. But we've got enough troops on the ground there that we thought that we would deter aggression. Yes, they did ask us to leave Subic and Clark, and largely because that was a basing agreement. That was unsatisfactorily negotiated and on our part as much as it was the Philippine political transformation democratization process. But I think it's a mistake to back away from the idea that America has a series of alliances in Asia to which we are committed and to which we provide strategic guarantees that we will be involved should conflict emerge. And I think that's the phrase that I think we got from the Taiwan Relations Act very nicely is we oppose the use of force to change the status quo. We oppose coercion in Asia. And I think I would be very cautious about undermining our language on the alliances, whichever alliance we're talking about, because that's really why we were there. The domestic debate that we have to have probably in this country, though, is to recognize that we don't have to call this a system. We don't have to link it to the Cold War. But we do have to understand what's at stake for for us going forward in these military cooperative relationships with Asia. And I think we ought to be very clear that we do have made promises, implicit or explicit, in the way we've organized our military forces in the region. And that communicates not only to our allies, but it communicates to others who may want to challenge our allies. So just to be very careful about the way we talk about these things, those commitments are very important to the region.
That's really essential. Euan.
Just on the military substance of the pattern of U.S. forward deployment, to emphasize this top heaviness, that still Japan is the most important, and Korea, the problem that you mentioned is that from a U.S. perspective, U.S. would like to have more flexibility about how it uses its own troops, as well as to get its allies more involved in a regional, more open scenario that would include the South China Sea, because I think the U.S. is also thinking not so much in the sort of siloed bilateral defense contingencies that we've been primarily talking about. That was the reference point in which the treaties were framed, but times have changed, and I think now we're looking much more at a sort of Indo-Pacific wide scenario in which the U.S. is looking for contributory forces. That's the limitation on the ROK U.S. treaty. Japan, I think that's really where the focus of U.S. The revision of the guidelines is going to come. Let's see how it shakes out when it's when it's released. Elsewhere, the other allies, the other treaties are a patchwork. I mean, they reflect the peculiarities under which they were signed. In the Philippines case, part of the problem is it was signed before the Philippines even had its claims in the Spratly. So that's it's a legal wrinkle which gives, I think, the US some separation in the form of its security guarantee, although it does still apply to public vessels. Even Australia, the relation, the wording of the treaty, interestingly, it doesn't require either side to commit their armed forces. It's merely to consult together and to act together to meet the common threat. Hasn't stopped the US and Australia from fighting in every war since 1951.
We just have a few more minutes, but I would be failing in my job if the former U.S. ambassador to the Philippines and to Indonesia, who have both raised their hands, if I didn't give them just a couple, a few moments to say what's on their minds, and then we'll just go for just final thoughts from each of our panels. So Cameron, and then Nick, and then the three of you, and we have 3 minutes.
Cameron Hume, it's just to repeat a point that was made. When we talk about alliances, you can look at NATO, and it's essentially the same language. It's an obligation to consult. So I wouldn't go overboard in reading the Taiwan Relations Act and predicting what actually it the significance would be in the case of certain circumstances. Thank you.
Yep. And now Nick Platt. Yep.
Ian's right. This is a patchwork of relationships developed under completely different circumstances. I did the renegotiation of the treaty in the Philippines, which was then rejected by the Philippine Senate, and we were then turfed out. But the point I think that we should make, and Herb is right, this is not a system. This is a skein of relationships that all developed at different times and are now responding to a new phenomenon, which is the rise of China. So let's not try to be too literal about the terms of these documents, but let's think of them in psychological terms in the broad context of rebalancing. Containment is not an option with China. You can't contain China, but you can balance China. And this, how would I say, non-system skein of in relationships is very important in doing that.
Yep. Great point. So why don't we just go just straight across, just 30 seconds, final thoughts. Starting with you, Euan.
I'll finish where I started. But I think Southeast Asia is the kind of the crucible, the melting pot. It's where things are less certain, more flexible. I think that's where the rebalance ultimately will be judged, whether it was a success or a failure. And I don't think it'll be done on the narrow metric of whether a battalion of Marines was relocated here or there for training purposes. It's along the much broader front of answering the sustainability question, in which these broader considerations of the US as an investment power within the Pacific needs to receive greater emphasis, in which the TPP, I think, has assumed a very symbolic meaning, and I think a lot hangs on that.
Yep. Sheila.
I think it's clear from the conversation in this panel and earlier, you know, part of the challenge is being creative about how we think about the future with those allies traditionally, right? It's not just about military relationships. It has to be deeply about economic engagement. And we didn't come back to TPP on this panel, but it is fundamentally one of the pillars of our engagement in the Asia-Pacific region. There are also other domains, and there's this really interesting new book I've been reading. Part dystopian thriller, part love story. It's called The Genesis Code, and it looks at the American-Chinese genetic arms race. So I recommend it to you by our presider and moderator, Jamie Hassel. But seriously speaking, in addition to buying Jamie's book, we have to think creatively because we live in a different world. We don't live in 1950 or 1990s with the Philippines or Japan, Korea, Australia. This is a collective effort at building a new Asia Pacific, and we have to do it in the most creative way possible. Yeah. But we can't allow it to undermine the relationships that we've built for many decades.
Absolutely. Scott, final word.
I'm sure that in a decade we can all come back and debate whether or not we have a U.S. alliance system and what its future is.
Terrific. Well, thank you all very, very much, and thank you to our panelists.